GHRT Rewinds are brought to you by Laughlin and Wolfington Realty. Mike and Nate and Harrison teaming up to help you sell your home faster and for top dollar. In the Newsmakers Hour, our continuing coverage of what will be the vote on the March ballot that might see the restoration of a parent's rights to exempt their child from an immunization based on religious or philosophical reasons. This morning, Kara Sachs of the Veto 798 effort is dialing in on the PDQ door telephone line. Is the bacon out of the oven yet?
Not yet. Thanks for having me on again, Rick.
Now, George isn't here, and George has taken a clear side in this issue, if you listen to past interviews. He's not here, so I'm right in the middle of the road on this with you, Kara. And I want to follow up because I think that you heard our conversation after we last had you on. Proponents of immunization rights being taken away, and even the way I word it becomes controversial, but those who supported the measure to see that everyone must have an immunization if they're going to be going to kids going to school in the state of Maine, they sent a Dr. Blaisdell, a pediatrician, and said, would you talk to Dr. Blaisdell? We did. And I'm wondering if you heard that conversation we had with Dr. Blaisdell.
I sure did.
Okay. And so I would ask you, was there anything in our conversation with Dr. Blaisdell that you found of interest or perhaps bothered you and said, well, maybe people need to hear some additional information?
I did. I had a chance to listen to Laura's interview, and I noticed that you had asked a great question, Rick, about the science and safety of vaccines. And she answered in a way that we've been hearing throughout the legislative session, which is that's not what we're here to talk about. And the science of vaccines is settled. There's really nothing to discuss when it comes to safety. And I thought that was really not a great answer for the listeners and something I would love to just touch on.
I'd welcome you to do so. One listener, after hearing that question and then hearing Dr. Blaisdell's response, said, well, Big Pharma told us that OxyContin was safe, too, and it wasn't addictive.
Yes.
And now what has happened? So even though in the past, and George frequently likes to bring up, and yes, rightly so, immunizations have certainly played a role in seeing the demise of some dread diseases. However, the question was, are we confident that what we're injecting our children with today continues to be safe? So what was your thoughts beyond that?
Yeah. And so my thought on that is, you know, the communities that are pushing these kinds of legislations that, you know, again, it's really not about vaccination. It's about freedom. And what greater freedom is there than to decide what is injected into your own body? They constantly say the science is settled, they're safe and effective, and there's no more information given. And what we know, and we have many doctors, physicians, medical professionals that support a patient's right to choose. It's not that they're discouraging vaccines, but they want parents and adults to be able to decide for themselves and make informed decisions, that doctors are really not trained on vaccines in medical school. They're told that they're safe and effective and they should give them according to the CDC schedule. So, you know, that's something to consider. There's really not a lot of studies that are done on vaccines in particular. And there's something called, that many listeners probably have never heard of, it's called the National Vaccine Injury Compensation Program. And this was established in the 80s. And you would probably be very surprised to hear that the government gave the pharmaceutical companies, the same ones that produce OxyContin and all of these other medications, are the same companies that make vaccines, liability or immunity from being sued related to vaccinations. So every time you get a shot, your child gets a vaccination, you actually pay yourself. The government doesn't pay it. The companies don't pay it. You pay 75 cents on every dose into a fund, and this fund pays out for injuries. There have been over $4 billion paid out for injuries to families related to injuries incurred from vaccinations.
Well, okay, let me jump in. Why haven't we heard that? Why haven't I don't know. I don't know if I have read that.
I want you to hear that. You've probably not heard it. You've probably never read it. Nobody wants you to hear it. The media, you know, I think it's like 75% of advertising in the media is paid for by a pharmaceutical company. Most people don't know that. And you can Google it. It's, I think, on the CDC website. It's called the National Vaccine Injury Compensation Program, and they've paid out over $4 billion in injury. I believe the flu vaccine is actually the highest payout for injuries. So, I mean, I think that speaks for itself that, you know, vaccines may be safe for some, but they're not 100% safe for every person every time.
Okay.
That seems like pretty clear information to me.
Talking with Kara Sachs, Veto 798 effort. I'm trying to make my questions down the middle of the road following our conversation with Dr. Laura Blaisdell. We're trying to present both sides as best we can, short of getting you both in the studio for a debate. And I don't know if that's going to be able to happen, even as we approach the election in March. One of the other questions I asked Dr. Blaisdell was a point that you had made, Kara, and that others who have written in and said that they had a concern that lawmakers did not have all of the information they needed to make an educated and informed decision. I think you had indicated in a previous interview, Kara, that you felt that, no, they didn't. Dr. Blaisdell said, yes, they did. I know this becomes a she said, she said, but I want to follow up on something. I've since heard from others who were a part of the effort to restore parents' rights that during hearings in Augusta, and I'm asking you for verification on this, during hearings in Augusta on this issue, your side asked questions and were not provided answers, but rather were given, and I'm going to paraphrase, we'll get back to you on that. And their claim was, from the people with whom I've, with people not, from, I did not seek these people out, they came to me. They said to me, they never got back to us with the information they said they were going to get back. If they're not getting back to us, they felt they're not getting back to lawmakers. Dr. Blaisdell says lawmakers got all the information. You said they didn't get all the information. I want to give you a chance to rebut that.
Yeah. So one interesting fact, I had heard her mention that there was a phone line that was set up that legislators could call into. And that I believe was actually staffed by Dr. Blaisdell herself. And so I'm not sure that that's, you know, unbiased information from a doctor who is pushing removing patient rights. Also, it was actually a senator himself on the education committee who submitted in writing a request to the Maine CDC to answer some basic questions that were never, ever, ever provided. And those questions included, is there a documented case of an unvaccinated child making another child ill? You know, how many immunocompromised students would presumably gain access to school under this bill? How many children will be removed from school under this bill? Many, you would think, Rick, very basic questions that lawmakers would need to factor when they were making a decision this large. And the CDC could not answer the questions. They said, we don't keep that data. We don't know. No, we don't have any evidence of an immunocompromised child ever being made ill by an unvaccinated child. So very basic questions that were not answered, and that was in the work session for the bill.
I want to ask one other question about, you referred to Dr. Blaisdell as Laura just a moment ago. I don't know if you know her from in the past or you've encountered her before.
I don't know her personally. I just know her. She was one of the biggest advocates for the bill in the legislative session.
Okay. Someone had indicated to me that she has been in the state before working as an advocate, and then she moved out of the state and then returned to the state to be a point person on this. That's what someone had indicated to me. I have no way to fact check that. I'm not making an accusation. I'm not making a statement. I'm just asking if you have heard any of the same thing.
Yeah, I'm not sure. Like I said, I don't know her personally. I know she is with the American Academy of Pediatrics in Maine, or has been in the past. I don't want to make a false statement.
Right.
And physician organizations are very often lobbied by the pharmaceutical industry on these kinds of bills. There's, you know, reputable journal articles that talk about Big Pharma's playbook involved there. So, yeah, I mean, I can't draw conclusions. I know Dr. Blaisdell was very involved in the legislative session. We've just been hearing from her again with some quotes and things like that more recently. So I know this is a passion of hers. As she calls it, vaccine hesitancy. So I'm sure we'll be hearing a lot more from her.
Okay, I want to state very clearly that I'm not making an accusation concerning her past or her present. I'm just curious as to whether or not she has been working in other states on this cause, and if she was out of state and returned to Maine for it. I'm just asking that question. The final thing is, there was talk about Maine Families for Vaccines. She spoke of Maine Families for Vaccines, and it's a grassroots group that was formed and made comparisons to your organization that had paid signature gatherers. And I'm wondering if you have any insight into that.
Yeah, I heard that. So I think the average listener probably doesn't know. You know, I'm just a mom. I've not been involved in the political process before, that the vast majority of referendums that you're signing, those are all paid signature gatherers. It's very, very, very difficult to get volunteers out. And when you're canvassing, collecting signatures, you're essentially a botherer, a professional botherer. Nobody really wants to be asked to sign these things. So we actually collected 92% of our signatures were from volunteers. It's surprising to me that that was never covered in the media, because as we understand it from political experts, it's a pretty unprecedented grassroots effort. We turned in 95,000 signatures, and just about 92% of those were collected by volunteers. And we did hire paid canvassers to ensure that, you know, every voter in Maine who wanted the opportunity to sign the petition was able to. We did not end up needing those signatures. We turned in an extra 16,000 valid, verified signatures. You know, that's just a false statement. And I did notice, I think, that there just one opposition group of many that will likely, turn out against us on the bill. They'd, I think, turned in, you know, $1, and they had started their PAC filing on the day that we turned in our signature. So it'll be interesting for us to watch. I think it's very unlikely that the pharmaceutical industry, that Big Pharma, is not going to spend money in our state. Mm-hmm. And it'll be interesting for us to try to figure out and see if that spending is transparent, and if the voters of Maine are actually able to see that.
GHRT Rewinds, brought to you by your hometown real estate team, Laughlin and Wolfington Realty. Thinking about selling your home? Call 629-9211 and start packing.